August 8th, 2016 CPDC meeting. We're going to take a couple of things out of order right now. We're going to start with the approval not required for 116 Van Norden, and then we'll do the plan endorsement for 149 Van Norden. And then we'll do the public hearing for the zoning amendments for November. So Julie, anything you want to kick us off with as it relates to 116 Van Norden?
Sure. So it's an approval not required plan that's creating one buildable lot with frontage along Van Norden Road that meets the requirements of the S20 zoning district, and then one parcel which does not meet the requirements of the S20 zoning district and has been labeled as not a buildable lot. The applicant did go before the Board of Appeals for a variance for the lot shape. They received it, and there's a note on the plans indicating such. So I believe this plan is endorsable.
All right. Any questions on this one?
I mean, it was just hard to figure out what the new lines were.
Yeah.
I could see where it was, but.
All right.
I can point them out to you if you're wondering. So this, if you follow my cursor.
Yeah. Okay.
Right here. And then there's like a little lot line back here. That is the buildable lot, Lot A.
Oh, I got that.
Yeah.
But because the property immediately west of that is owned by someone else, it was hard to tell where do they separate parcel A from lot A?
See where my cursor is? It's right here.
Yeah.
And then it looks like it goes along here.
No, that would have been the property of the other person.
No, this
so it's
one.
Just a little, no?
Fine. This one belongs to somebody else.
So it's just a little piece.
It gets
that.
Really narrow going back here, and then parcel A is this whole thing back here.
Right.
Right.
So it's just this little piece.
Yeah,
right
so
here.
This is the the dividing line.
All right.
Right. Okay. All right. Karen, any questions?
So you have two Mylars and a special pen.
Well,
and it's the one that's rolled.
We need to make a motion.
Sure. Move that the CPDC endorse the approval not required plans for 116 Van Norden Road.
Second. All those in favor? All right.
Three signatures is enough.
Mm-hmm.
Shapes that we've been discussing too, right?
Yeah, and actually in this case, Glenn advised me to actually need a variance because he doesn't actually use that bylaw, but they'd already filed for it.
Oh.
They just went ahead with it.
Wow, that's a pretty fat pen.
Jeff, you've signed both, right?
Yeah.
You've signed both. Okay.
So one goes to you and one?
And one goes to them.
Okay.
Here. We'll see. And actually, you need that for the next step.
Oh, okay.
All right. Next up on the agenda, plan endorsement for 149 Van Norden Road. Well, I'll give Julie a second to... Thank you.
Thank you for your time,
Paul. Thank you. All right, so Julie, any comments on 149?
Yeah.
Van Norden Road?
So there were a number of prior to endorsement conditions of your PRD decision, and I went through the ones that were required from planning, and they have satisfied all of them, and engineering is satisfied that they've met all the prior to endorsement engineering conditions. And they wrote a memo, which is included, the town engineer. So I'm satisfied that it's something that you can endorse.
Okay.
Is this Jesse Wilson?
It is.
Is that the one? Okay.
This is the last step for you guys.
All right.
I can release Mr. Latham.
All right, well, that's really good. I'm happy that we've made it this far. Any questions, comments?
No.
No? All right. Got a motion?
Move that the CPDC endorse the plan for 149 Van Norden Road, PRD. Second.
All those in favor? All Yeah, you're welcome.
Thanks.
You want?
Yes. Perfect. And so, Brad, you only want.
All right. Moving right along.
Now for the real fun.
These are the best public comments because they're paid for.
Do we have the public notice?
No, I actually think I left it in my office.
Can we dispense with the reading of the public notice? It was posted.
It's fine. Right. Your usual habit is to read the notice. You should do
it. Well, we do it at town meeting all the time, right?
Yes, but you do it at town meeting all the time. That's the point. Here, you don't do it all the time. Here, you actually usually read it, right?
Yeah.
Because they're short.
Sure.
But say one were to be longer. If one were longer, could we dispense with it or cut it in half? Just asking about proceedings. I'm not asking about whether we should or shouldn't. I'm asking about whether.
So, technically, you can skip the step completely if you want. But what you don't want to be doing is doing it doing it one way for one kind of hearing and another way for a different hearing. So if you want to adopt a procedure where you don't read it,
mm-hmm.
that's fine, and that will become your new uniform procedure, but you shouldn't be varying the procedure from one to another.
Okay. All right, well, next up on our agenda, public hearing for the zoning bylaw amendments. November 2016 town meeting, Section 8, the sign bylaw recodification revisions to bring it into compliance with the recent Supreme Court ruling. Nick will, with pleasure, read the public.
Notice is hereby given that under MGL Chapter 48, Section 5, the Reading Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, August 8, 2016 at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to consider the following proposed zoning bylaw amendments in advance of the November 2016 subsequent town meeting: recodification of Section 8 signed bylaw and revisions to bring it into compliance with a recent Supreme Court ruling. Complete drafts of the proposed amendments are available to the public in the Public Services Office in Town Hall Monday through Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m. and on the town's website on the Community Planning and Development Commission page.
All right, thank you. So I expected a couple of people here. I was going to ask Nick to kind of provide a brief overview of the work that was done. However, I don't know if that's necessary given everyone here has pretty much been involved in the work to some degree. So, looks like we have a few versions here. I see a town council's version, I see a bold cross out version, and then questions with some responses, and Tony, something from Tony as well. So is there any thoughts on how we want to proceed with this? There.
I just received town council's draft at 4:38 p.m., so
okay.
I've only looked it over to see that it's gross.
That it's gross?
Well, just a lot of red line.
And it's redline based on which version?
On the public hearing draft.
Okay.
Based on our clean proposed version.
Okay.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
And truly, there are a few more things that I'd like to do to it, but I just ran out. Basically, as you know from prior discussions, the Reed decision prohibits sign regulations that are based on content. And the key thing in the Reed case was that regulating signs by function is the same as regulating them by content. So if you try to describe a sign by its function, you're going to be in trouble. So we had a few leftover, so the public hearing draft represents a big step forward from the current bylaw, but there were still a few residual things that we objected to. We tried to, and I appreciate that some of the things that we objected to were in the model that we provided you. IMLA model, the International Municipal Law Association model that we provided you, had some definitions that on closer examination we weren't terribly happy with. We went through, I think we have come up with definitions that would satisfy the Supreme Court. I also took out a few things right at the beginning. The you see in 8.1, there's a paragraph that I took out that talks about balancing the need for communication with free speech. That's just inviting trouble. Free speech is not something that one balances against things like economic vitality. So we don't need to say that that's what we're doing. A little bit farther down, 8.1.2, the provision that talks about what the building inspector can do. I took the whole section out because the building inspector's powers are set forth elsewhere in the bylaw, and you don't want to have powers in two different places. So I took those out. What I have not succeeded in doing yet, at the end of it, there is a table that summarizes a whole lot of provisions. And I don't think you want to have the table and the text repeating. That is, the table should either be the governing provision or the text, and supplemented by the text, but you don't want the same prohibition in both places. I didn't quite get to those. If you scroll down to the definitions, you'll see there was a definition of adult language, and there was a provision that suggested that you can't have adult language on signs. But the sad and bitter truth is that you're only allowed to regulate the content of signs if the content, well, in this dimension, if the content actually meets the definition of obscenity. So I took out adult language and put in obscenity elsewhere in proper alphabetical order. We try to go with that. I believe that the definition of flashing lights and the definition of animated signs, electronic sign, really covers it. And the two places are only used, the only place they appear in the text, they are in the same sentence. You know, so it's like flashing or electronic. That's the reason I took it out.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Yes.
Maybe I missed what you said. Why did you take out section 8.15, navigating the sign bylaw?
It's not a substantive provision.
Is it unconstitutional?
No, but
okay,
it's not a substantive provision. It tells people how they're supposed to use it, which may not be the only way that somebody wants to use it. So I don't think it's good practice to have that there. My rule was that it was okay to make changes if they weren't substantive. I consider that to be not substantive. It's not a necessary provision. It doesn't actually add anything. Best way to navigate this bylaw would be to make it as shorter as it can be. So, the definition of government sign, I imported a whole lot of material that was in the substantive provisions. I put it in the definition so that it's clear what a government sign is, rather than have to look at two different places. I would get down to the provisions governing authorized signs, there's a whole lot of material here about temporary signs, which I attempted to clean up because I wasn't sure I could follow it. And so I would invite you, not now, but at some point, to study that carefully to make sure that I have properly captured the meaning. That you want.
Why did you remove the definition for portable sign?
I'm sorry?
Why did you remove the definition on page 6 for portable sign?
Portable sign?
Yeah.
I don't even have that definition. It's not taken out. It's just not there.
Here.
Interesting. It's not on there, is it? Okay.
Okay.
A permit attached to the ground or any permanent structure or any sign permanently designed to be transported in any way, regardless of modifications that limit its mobility, when the sign is converted to A. Okay. So we have A-frame, we have sandwich board, and we have portable sign. They seem to overlap, which is the reason. To pick one versus the other.
Yeah, but this would apply to, say, a sign on a trailer that somebody takes and takes the wheels off, for example, and changes to a post.
Well, we already have a provision that things that are attached to a vehicle are going to be considered temporary signs. The only place the word portable appears is in the definition of A-frame or sandwich board. It's not a substantive provision. And
so what will prohibit somebody from taking a modified trailer and planting it in front of their property as a permanent sign? Or
as
a
permanent sign. As a
permanent took off the wheel. That's what this would apply to. So we're going to.
But there's nothing there's nothing in here to prohibit that anyway. The only use of the word portable in the bylaw was to say that an A-frame or sandwich board sign was a category of portable sign. Other than that, there are no prohibitions against portable signs. The thing that you're talking about was regulated as a temporary sign. And that is still if you look at 8.4, prohibited signs, and you go to subsection I, among the things that are prohibited are signs attached to or painted on vehicles parked on or visible from any public right of way, unless such vehicle and sign are used in the normal day-to-day operation of business. I think that's covered.
Which letter was that? Sorry.
I.
You are.
Oh. Right, why did you take out, on page 12, number 3, which is under temporary signs, permitted in all zoning districts?
Page, you're not going to be able to do it by page, because my version is different from...
I'm looking at a printout of the version you sent me at 438.
Can I have the balloons on the side?
No.
Oh, okay. What section number are you talking about?
8.3B3. Starts with any establishment located in a business or industrial zoning district.
Okay.
It's about flags.
There's a B missing in 8.3.
Yeah, there is.
No, it's at the top of page 11.
No, that's big B, right? So...
Like, see, it goes A, B, and then there's a 3.
Right, but A, 8.3A,
yep.
Where it says accept,
yep.
Immediately below that is A.
Oh, and there's no B, okay.
No B.
Once all the track changes are out,
yeah.
It'll be a lot easier to see what's
okay.
Missing.
Yep.
But I'll write that.
Okay, so you're looking at Romanet 3 under that on a site that has received definitive subdivision mm-hmm. approval, that?
No, I'm looking at any establishment located in a business or industrial zoning district may display during hours of operation a flag not exceeding 4
oh,
by 6.
Oh, I just moved it.
Okay.
It's in the part that has to do with business and industrial districts. So that since that
okay.
provision only is applicable in business and industrial districts, I moved it to the section that deals with business and industrial districts.
Okay, sounds good. And is it clarified there that it's temporary? Because the reason it's here is because it was temporary. Operation's probably good enough to cover. It's temporary, but it happens every day.
It's not temporary if it if.
Set out page 16.
Oh, right here. L. Sign. It should
right
be signed.
Master signage plan.
Yes.
Okay, I get it. Yep.
But then if we put it there, signs in all business. I'm not so sure I want to give up on the portable sign thing yet. It may just need to be prohibited somewhere. Because I don't think they're the same as A-frame or T. A or T-frame signs. I think it's something somebody rigs up. An A-frame sandwich board is sort of a, you know, folding device. You buy as such, sandwich board. But somebody could take a trailer-mounted sign
mm-hmm.
and decide that that's their A-frame.
Okay, that's fine, and that's, I mean, this needs to be a bit of an iterative process. I took it out because there is no substantive provision. The only reference anywhere to portable signs is in the definition of A-frame and sandwich board that says they're a portable sign. And to my way of thinking, if that's the only use of it, you don't need a definition of portable sign because you know kind of what an A-frame and sandwich board looks like. You have something else different in mind which you also want to prohibit. It's not prohibited now.
Right.
So if you want to prohibit it, you can put the definition back in there and then you can prohibit it. But
okay.
It's not there now, so that's something that we can certainly add back.
It looks like you took out all of the allowed prohibited.
Yeah, here's my rule. You don't say the same thing twice, okay? And as I think I indicated, I didn't manage to capture all of these. You have a table at the back, at the end, that says which things are allowed and whether a permit is needed. And then you have substantive provisions that say these things are allowed again. You don't want to say it twice. If you say it twice and there's any difference in the way it's laid out or set up, that's an exploitable argument by some clever lawyer that it really doesn't mean the same thing or something. You want to say, when you say something, you want to say it once. And you want to make sure you say it the way you want it said. So I think what you want to do is to have the table be the place where your substantive provisions are and then supplemented by the text. You can also do it the other way, which is to get rid of the table and put everything in the text. That's a style question that you may want to weigh in on. But what you don't want to do is to have it in the table and have it in slightly different form in the text. That's an invitation for disputes.
So there's a lot of changes here. Is it in our best interest to go through these all now, or do we take some time and review them on our own and come back?
I mean, we have a lot of time.
And that's the issue.
That was my next question.
Yeah,
I wanted to go through his comments, just their comments too, make sure that there wasn't some major piece.
We've gotten pretty far through their comments, and we haven't gone through every single one, but I still would like to hear the rationale behind a lot of the changes in here from him.
That's fine. I'm just...
And then hear what you guys think in return, in response.
Yeah, that's fine. So, my apologies. Where were we?
Well, I lost my spot as well. Basically, 851 is basically.
Yeah, so like signs by zoning district.
Right.
It's on page 13. That's where it starts.
Yep. So in 851A, there are two sentences. There is two sentences at the end that I question whether they belong. I didn't take them out, but I just question whether they belong there. All awnings and canopies shall have a minimum ground clearance of 8 feet. Ground clearance shall be measured between the lowest point of the awning or canopy and the ground or sidewalk. Is it your intention that those provisions only apply if the awning has a sign on it, or are you, or is that a rule that you want to apply to all awnings?
It applies to all of them.
If it applies to all awnings and canopies, it needs to be somewhere else. Not the sign, by the way. It applies only to awnings and canopies that have signs on them. Then we need to say that.
I think we need to say that somewhere in here.
I agree.
Or no one will ever know it's there.
Also, we don't want to be like making random changes to the rest of the bylaw. that we haven't advertised.
All true. Okay. That's why I didn't take it out. You want the sentence to read awnings and canopies containing awning signs shall have a minimum ground clearance. Yes?
So that it's specific to signs.
Yeah.
That implies that it's different somewhere else.
Yeah.
Well, it is different somewhere else. Right now, you don't have that provision anywhere else. So that means there is no requirement that awnings be of certain height. So unless it has a sign, it can be as low as the.
We don't have a building code, code clearance over a public way.
Yeah, the building code has that, but there's nothing else in the zoning. The zoning would just default to the building code. If you want to default to the building code, then you don't need this. But if you want to make special rules for awnings that have signs, then that's what then you can write that.
I think it needs to be in here. I think it's okay if we have too many words. Because if we were just going to write a zoning bylaw that said signs shall not suck, and everyone's supposed to understand what that means, we'll never get the right signs. So if we don't say it here and someone says, well, it's somewhere else, well, where is it?
Okay.
And then they start looking through zoning, they won't find it. They'll start looking through the general bylaw, they won't find it there until somebody smartens up and realizes they're supposed to look at the building code.
It's a wild goose chase. Mm-hmm.
Okay. We're trying to make it simpler for the person, the unsavvy code person to look at this and try to understand somewhat what they needed. I guess that was the rule. If it were up to me, it'd be written like the building code, and I don't care whether you can understand it or not, because the building code's enforceable. And there's few disputes about the building code, and it's written it's in code language. Mm-hmm. You don't have to be used to reading it.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to Tony Durezzo, 130 Jones Street, civilian member of the Signed Bylaw Rewrite Committee. I just wanted to second Mr. Safina's comments that part of our goal here wasn't just the legalese,
sure,
which I'm sure the council is going over with a fine-tooth comb, but it was supposed to also try and be able to be read by laypersons or businesses so they understand what they have a shot at when they go to apply for a sign.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And sometimes that takes different tactics, right? Sometimes you want to remove things that are stated twice. Sometimes you want to add more language to make it clearer.
So we just have to strike that balance. But I agree, we definitely want to make it easier for those that are not familiar working with these types of documents.
Table is an easy way to summarize everything, including dimensional criteria. It's easier to say something about dimensions,
mm-hmm,
in a table than it is to write it out.
Yeah. But
are you suggesting that
we just put it in the table?
Well, no, I'm saying the intent with the allowed and prohibited signs in each section was so that you could quickly, as you went to your section, see what was allowed or prohibited. That was our intent. And I understand your concern is if we start duplicating this, we may make an error in one or the other and then run into trouble. So if we're going to eliminate it in one of these two sections, I think that we should keep the table. Or we should keep the table form and eliminate some of the language.
Yeah.
That's shorter. We may just have more footnotes. End up with a bunch of notes.
Well, some of those footnotes actually might be able to go away because they're references to the text, you know. So maybe some of them may go away.
We could reference back to the text instead of a footnote. Mm-hmm. No, forward, no, no.
Okay.
I do have a question. Some of the graphics I provided, we didn't resolve. So, for example, sign area.
You were going to revise.
Can I still revise them?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think so, right?
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't sure if we were locked into something.
Did I remove them, actually?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no, they're here. Okay.
So the one that raised my eyebrow was that one there, the
Metroland
Bank drive-in branch.
Right.
That seems to contradict the text.
It does, and I had put this in here to see if we wanted to discuss. Originally put it in there to discuss what we wanted to include in that sign area. Do we want to be tight around the graphics, or do we just want to make it simple and go to the outer limits of whatever they're creating, which is the way it is now? It's simpler. It doesn't give the building inspector leeway to decide how far off the graphics to start that line, right? Mm-hmm. So the first one, which shows the T shape, if you will, tighter length. Tight around the letters, the top Metroland Bank one.
The one that says Metroland Bank, that one?
Right.
Okay.
That top one is not the way the code is written now. It's the bottom one. Right? He just takes the outer limits of the entire pack of graphics and says it's X by Y.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wanted to, I included both of those for discussion purposes. I think it should be the bottom one.
Okay, but that drawing, so a sign can have a rectangle and the graphics inside the rectangle, and the area of the sign would be defined by the area of the rectangle. But if there is no rectangle, are you saying that it's the limits of the board, or is it the limits of some imaginary rectangle?
You draw the rectangle from the outer limits of all of the elements.
What do you consider to be an element?
Any part of the sign. We got into this discussion about where. Right. So you've got some kind of graphic, and you've got some kind of sign text.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever can encompass that entire piece, right? And we got into a discussion mm-hmm. about what happens if they have multiple words like this. Is this two signs? And if they space this out too far, they'll exceed the limits that they're allowed. And so then it would either have to be two signs, or they have to bring them in closer together. So we don't want to define what that gap is. It's always the outer limits of any graphics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's going
to
be way
up. Right up to the edge of the graphic.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Because this one here, you know, let's say these are you know, fat letters or something. How close to that does the inspector have to decide he is as he's coming up with it? So this simple rectangle.
I'm making a rectangle.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
So that's like that's left over from our discussion. I just never cleaned it up.
Smallest rectangle enclosing all the signs, characters, letters, and other graphic.
I can actually get rid of the top Metroland Bank one, and we can draw something that represents that. One with just text and one with some graphics, like a logo and some text.
Right. It doesn't match, but it can be made to match.
Yeah.
And that works.
I had a comment about the our new definition that town council is including on the obscene signs, whatever. That definition I know what you're trying to say, but I wonder if there's another way of saying it.
It's on page 6.
I'm sure that will get the attention of town meeting.
It sure will.
So.
And there's not, you know, I mean,
I mean, how do you?
We don't. There aren't many signed bylaws that even go here.
That okay. So this is uncharted territory.
All right. And I don't know. It's uncharted.
This is the pre-Supreme Court decision, Don. You know my comment was I can make a sign that says anything and you can't regulate that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So the definition is taken directly out of the case, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And again, we're trying to get to...
It's a U.S. Supreme Court case.
Okay. So the goal here is to try and define signs that may go along with something related to adult entertainment or whatever we're calling it.
Mm-hmm.
And this is probably the only time this would come up.
So, remind me, because I just don't remember. The provisions we already have for adult entertainment already have limits on the sign, right?
Well, I think you revised what we had in here.
You mean in other parts of the bylaw?
Yes.
I mean in this
in the part of the zoning bylaw.
It was under adult language definition.
Adult
and it's new.
No, I'm talking about
currently
existing bylaw in the adult entertainment provision.
I don't think so.
That wasn't my point though.
No.
I'm talking about a children's clothing store.
Yes.
And I decide to put a sign up that says F you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You can't regulate the content.
That's right.
It's not about adult entertainment. It's about the words.
Yeah.
And I'm asking you whether we can regulate that.
Only if it's obscene.
Well, you're saying that this was only related to adult entertainment.
No.
We wrote adult entertainment.
You wrote adult language. And I am saying you can't regulate adult language. In the sun.
Okay.
The only thing you can regulate is if it's obscene.
We do.
Whether it's related to adult entertainment or not.
We don't have any definitions related to adult.
No, there's nothing in the definitions. I feel like it's a little noisy.
Is it under prohibits?
Is it overlay? I think it's in the overlays. Is it adult?
Honestly.
It's my medical.
Doesn't come up that often, guys.
But now we're in a different order. This is a different world now, right? This decision says you can't regulate any content, and I'm saying I could put an unrelated to whatever my business is, I can write whatever I want on this sign.
So in 5625D, that's the part that regulates adult entertainment.
Okay.
It has a provision governing signs in there. It says all signs for any adult use shall satisfy the requirements of section 8.0 of the zoning bylaw hereof, provided, however, that no advertisement, display, or other promotional material that contains sexually explicit graphics or sexually explicit text shall be visible to the public from a public way, sidewalks, pedestrian walkways, highways, or railways. Now, if we were fooling with this, I would probably get rid of the part that says it contains and just say no sign of pertinent to an adult use can be visible.
What
visible.
If it's a sign that's not pertinent to adult use and not related to adult use at all, like what Nick said?
That's what I'm saying. The limit is just obscenity.
Okay. So in the current bylaw,
and
5.6.2.5D,
right.
We do reference signs.
Right.
For adult.
What I'm saying is that, you know, when we go back to clean things up, we're not fooling with 5625, but when we go back to clean things up, we probably have to clean that one up too.
But what I'm saying is this is limited to signs that are related to an adult use.
That's right.
And so it wouldn't cover areas of town where someone just puts in their front lawn a big sign that
says
FU. Right next to a daycare.
Sorry. That's what the First Amendment says.
We'll get rid of that.
The marketplace of ideas is supposed to register. People are supposed to be sufficiently outraged that they will
please.
Okay? I mean, that's the theory.
But that could be
Tony?
Mr. Chairman, Tony DeRosa, 130 John Street. I object to the phrase appurtenant. What is that
I
word?
Know.
Appurtenant.
Appurtenant.
only because I have no clue what it means.
Adjacent.
No, it means pertaining to.
Why doesn't it mean not pertaining to?
Really,
I thought A before something was not.
Spelled differently.
Not.
It's this, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh.
Two P's. So
where is that?
One B.
Oh, there it is.
Like anomalous.
I'm just telling you that's what it means. What does it say? Then? I can't remember what does it say.
But see, this is weird because then the it says belonging or pertinent, but then use it in a sentence says secondary buildings that are appertinent to the main building.
Uh-huh.
Pertaining or belonging.
So
they are like related in some way.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then here it says appurtenant, adjective, pertaining to something that attaches. Thank you very much.
Where are we?
we've gone way off the reservation here, because we were talking about how we might change the sign regulation in the adult district.
No. Well, we started talking about that, but
that's
my
where
point
the word appurtenant came.
Signs
from.
Not related to any adult uses.
Mm-hmm.
You can write anything you want on that sign,
mm-hmm.
and we can't say no.
That's correct.
You want to know that?
Unless it's obscene.
Well, but here you're saying you don't say that.
Where don't I say it?
People shouldn't have to put the dictionary.
Do we think this applies to words?
What?
Curse words, swear words.
The definition of obscenity? No,
yeah.
Absolutely not.
Okay, then you can't regulate it.
That's correct.
My example was a children's clothing store called FU.
That's
right.
Right? That's right.
You can't regulate that.
That is correct.
Okay, so then why are we putting this in here? This is only about an adult entertainment.
No, he's taking it from case law. In case law, was
no,
obscene,
we're mixing
right?
up two things. In the adult entertainment bylaw,
that's
there is a provision governing signs that needs to be cleaned up.
Yeah.
Right.
Here we're regulating signs and we're not singling out
adults.
But
okay.
Signs that pertain to any particular use. We're just saying the limits of your regulatory authority is you can prohibit obscenity, but after that you can't prohibit anything else.
So the wording of this is kind of where I'm having some difficulty. We're trying to make this really user-friendly, like we keep saying,
mm-hmm.
and we use words like prurient and patently offensive, and you know, can we just do like simple, if it's a this or if it's a that?
I just think the building inspector is going to have trouble with this section because it doesn't say that it regulates words, so he won't know whether he should be or shouldn't be regulating the words if they are offensive,
obscene,
or obscene.
Yeah, I think it's...
I'm okay saying no. We can't regulate. I just want to know what we're going to say because the building inspector needs to know what we're going to say.
Well, you have two choices, really. You can do what most of our other towns are doing, which is we don't go there. You just don't say anything about adult or obscene or anything. You just say nothing. Okay?
And let society just deal with it as it will.
Well, yeah. Or you can say we'll regulate to the limits of our authority, which, as you see, is not that much. So it has
mm-hmm.
to be pretty, pretty far gone to be considered obscene.
Okay. So if we leave this here, where do we prohibit obscene material in this section?
Town meeting will have a field day with this definition. I just really do.
I know.
Okay, so it's 8.4, the last one. What's that? N. Where did it go?
I don't know.
Whichever is the last.
N. On page 13.
Yeah.
Same language or images. See, you say language here, but. Over here, on the definition, it says matter. Right.
Yeah. Right. Adult matter.
You're telling me we couldn't, obscene language is okay, the word language?
Mm-hmm.
So you, if you want to make that change in the definition and say language or images are obscene, if you do that.
No, I don't want to say that there.
Okay.
Say in the definitions. Gene, you're saying just delete this entire right here?
I'm sorry, say that again?
I'm just,
I
you
just
say nothing.
I just see this as being a, like a 3-hour debate on the floor of town meeting. This one definition.
Okay.
I know that would never happen.
You don't think I can shut it down just by saying this is the definition that the U.S. Supreme Court gave us?
That is not going to fly. I would say either let's figure it out in a really simple way, or maybe if you just want to leave it as a prohibited...
And not define it?
Yeah.
I'm happy to not define it, because the Supreme Court gave us a definition, so that's the one we have to use. I'm not happy trying to simplify
it, okay.
Because once you start changing the words,
yeah.
Somebody will come up with some reason why our definition is not proper.
Okay. So
I would rather if you want to go down that road and want to keep the prohibition on obscene signs, I'd rather just, but you're trying to avoid debate.
Yep.
Just take the definition out.
Okay.
It won't change the rule.
And we can fall back on the Supreme Court's definition.
Supreme Court's
yes, if we have
that
to go there.
That means the Supreme Court's definition.
Okay.
Someone,
yeah.
If anybody at town meeting asks, you will have the Supreme Court's definition.
Okay. So have it on a slide somewhere in case they want to see it.
See what's obscene.
So what does that mean for N under prohibited?
We're going to leave it exactly what
it
is.
Yep.
Signs that contain obscene language or images.
Yep.
Okay.
Right. Well, we're just going to take out the definition, so because we don't
want to have that debate.
We don't want to have it.
Are there any other comments while we're going through?
Do you have public comment at some point?
We will, yeah. We will.
Are you there?
Open it up.
I have a couple more.
Okay.
It looks like you took out under exempt or authorized signs. Signs on properties occupied by churches or religious institutions or owned by other federally exempt, federally tax exempt. Took away your original art displays, took away fuel pump information. Did we move this or is it just deleted? This is 8.3.
Page 10. Yeah. I know you moved this stuff under A, under the definition.
Yeah.
But then what about...
Signs on property occupied by churches or religious institutions or owned by other federally tax-exempt institutions. So... I don't know if the idea here is to codify the Dover Amendment. We just don't need it. It's educational and religious institutions can't regulate signs anyway. If you're attempting to be something more than that, then are you,
no, we weren't. But let's ask these two members of the public if they know what the Dover Amendment is. Not you. You're not public. You're town meeting. again, we were trying to make it so that somebody from one of these places opens it up, thinking
okay.
They need to get a permit for a sign, and they can see right away that they're not required to. We weren't trying to exceed any of the Dover Amendment.
All right. Well, this does exceed the Dover Amendment.
Which one?
Signs on property occupied by churches or religious institutions or owned by others. It's both a little net too narrow and a little too broad because it applies to all tax-exempt institutions, whereas the Dover Amendment only applies to
religious and educational uses. And it seems to have left out doesn't make a specific reference to educational uses. So we have some nice language in the other parts of the zoning that reference uses entitled to protection. It says religious and educational uses entitled to protection under Chapter 40A, Section 3. And if you want to reflect that, that's the language we should put in.
And what did you do with original art displays?
I think I took it down. So, I'm of two minds about original art display. And I have to acknowledge that what I put here before you reflects both. One is I don't think, I'm uncomfortable with the idea that we're going to say that some kinds of graphics are going to be singled out and allowed, even though they might very well look like a sign. So, you know, I just came back from San Francisco where they had at the Museum of Modern Art there, they had a whole exhibit on graphic posters from the 60s, all those psychedelic typography and what have you. Those are considered art apparently now, but they are signs. So I'm uncomfortable with the idea that we're going to make judgments about what's on display and what's a sign. But it is in the animal model.
Okay.
So we can put it back. Okay, the next one, the fuel pump information signs. Included those within the definition of governmental signs, so we don't have to deal with them separately. And and the last one, any sign within the structure, that contradicts the definition of sign. So there is. Anything that's located completely within an enclosed building and not exposed to view from the streetway already excluded from the definition of sign, so you don't have to say it's just not regulated.
I think there was a recent issue where, I think it was Brad that was involved in it. Was it the barbershop? Had a sign on a wall.
Yes.
A very shallow retail space. And there was a sign on the wall that was very visible from the outside. And I think he advised his client that that would be considered a sign.
And that's preserved here. It's only things that are not visible that are completely indoors and not visible from the outside that are excluded from the sign regulations. Now, I have to tell you that you know, when you start talking about signs that are, you know, 3 or 4 feet inside a window, and one of your requirements is, you know, how much of the window can be occupied by the sign. I don't know how to measure that, so we may have some difficulty enforcing.
I'm a little more concerned with something like a restaurant, where we want a lot of transparency in the storefront, and they may be doing vintage signs inside the building. They may have a lot of signage on the walls inside, and I just don't want to get into looking at any of that or having them worry about that.
Well, so the easy way to resolve this is not to count anything that's inside as a sign, whether it's visible or not, but that's a substantive change.
Well, inside but not attached to the window or door.
Yeah, okay. Right now, you're regulating as signs anything that is visible from the outside. That's your current sign bylaw does that, and this one does too. I'm not aware of any other town that goes that far. There are lots of towns that I don't necessarily know what they're doing. So if you're concerned about that, maybe the thing to do is to go back and tweak it so that only things that are actually attached to the glass count.
So that only the signs attached to the glass count as part of the 30% of the sign area.
Yeah, I guess I didn't think we were counting anything that wasn't attached to the glass.
Yeah,
I never did either.
The building inspector, the way he interprets it is, you know, really just limited to what's on the glass of the door and what's on the outside of the building.
So we're not really regulating.
We're not.
Telling them that, weren't we? Actually, there should be an or in here, probably. I guess I don't want somebody to think that they can't decorate the inside of their space because they're concerned that it's going to count as signage. We'll have to just reword this.
Mm-hmm. Tony?
Mr. Chairman, but also the corollary, you may have people putting up digital signage 4 or 5 feet outside of the window or off a window so that they can display it through the window.
Yeah, we have to think about what that means. I think the exercise place where the realtor was going to have video monitors, right? They all put video monitors on the inboard side on some interior wall, and then they're just flashing their properties or some advertisement. Do we get into that? How close to the window before it counts as a sign?
So what are we doing with this H? Are we leaving it out? Or are we tweaking it?
This is exempt signs. I think if we tweak it a little bit, we can just pretty much put somebody at ease that they're not. They don't have to worry about it.
Okay.
That's about it.
You okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. Yeah, as much as we can.
Okay. Well, let's open it up for comment. So I invite you to start if you would, sure.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Megan Young, 40 Oak Street, town meeting member. And this is the first time I've actually been to one of the meetings. I know that you've had business meetings and those kind of things. So I have a couple things. I really like the pictures. That's a very nice addition. I've seen situations where people have like roof height and that kind of thing and defying the man surge versus that was great. Some things that I was wondering, and I don't know if I just wasn't looking in the right place. Do we have, I know that one of the biggest things about the sign bylaw was that we were looking at what had happened in the Supreme Court. Do we have online what the AG's guidance was about it? And do we also have online what we did, what we changed in the sign bylaw to support the guidelines?
I'm going to look to staff for some help with that one, but I don't think we posted anything. Have we posted anything on our website?
I don't think so.
I think it would be extremely helpful because I know that we're making changes, but I seriously can't see, other than the fact that what I can see is we have a resident can have a temporary sign, can have one. I don't know if that's what this is about or if that's what the addition was that addressed it. But I do think for the town meeting members, if we understood the guidance and understood what we did with it, that'd be really helpful as we look through this. So
okay.
That's a comment. On the sign definition, I don't have the benefit of what our attorney has given us on the sign definition, but as you all said, you want to make it as clear and easy to read as possible, and I can tell you that the sign definition as it stands, which is one paragraph long with no sentences in between, is really hard to read and really hard to interpret. So I don't know if there were changes made, but it is, I don't know how many, 12 lines long with no stops. And I think that's, maybe it's better, but again, I haven't seen it. I would just say if you're going for clarity, it's not that clear yet. So that's one comment. With business A, it sounds like, I know you had business people come to it. And business A right now is allowed, under this, if I'm reading it right, they're allowed no A-frames and no wind or whatever that is, feather. They're not allowed either one of those. However, I know today they're doing it. Had there been a consideration about, especially if we're looking at economic vitality, have you looked into whether business A could have those same rules that business B does? If there's any downside to it or whatever? Because my point is they're doing it anyway, and then that's an enforcement issue within the town.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to put that out there. I don't own a business, but it's just something that's happening.
Yep.
Yeah, town council has advised us to not enforce the sign bylaw.
Not enforce the sign bylaw.
Correct.
Until we get it revised.
So that's why you're seeing things that are.
And so we're going to go back and say, okay, take all that out and enforce it, like we did the last time with all the other ones where we went down this path before, where we tried to enforce it, and it was like 40 or 50 things we had to go do, and it was a matter of not having enough bandwidth in town to handle that enforcement.
No, that wasn't what happened last time. Last time we didn't have the ability legally to enforce because the signs were grandfathered.
So we did all the work and it was...
Where we could do enforcement, we did it. But otherwise, legally, we didn't have the ability to enforce non-conforming signs.
Were there times, Gene, that I clearly remember you saying we just don't have enough bandwidth in town to handle the...
No, I mean... We don't have a lot of resources, and
okay.
we didn't go at it, you know, like in a matter of a week.
Yeah.
It took some time.
I have a lot of emails on. I remember that whole situation. I'm just wondering about business A, if by the way there's any harm in allowing that. Did you guys discuss it and just decide not to?
We've actually discussed a lot of things, including two signs in places where only one is allowed.
But
we're not putting that in
we're
play
not going
right
there.
Now. We're just trying to recodify, clean it up, and then come into compliance with the Supreme Court stuff.
So it's really just the Supreme Court, but in reality, there's a lot of changes that have been made.
They aren't changes to the, there's a lot of clarifications. There's not significant, substantive changes to the regulation.
All right.
Other than to try and come into compliance with the Supreme Court.
Okay, and that's the part that I can't see what we changed there. It's not obvious from this.
You'll see things that say instead of,
Well, the best example is political signs. We used to have a whole section regulating political signs. We don't have that anymore.
We have a moratorium
on the limits on number of temporary signs before and after an election.
But for me, I was reading that I, as a resident, can have one temporary sign.
Mm-hmm.
Is that true?
No.
Except before and after election, you can have as many as you want.
No, that's not true either. If you look at page 11,
it's right here.
Temporary signs,
page
right?
12, actually.
So, I don't understand yet. So, if we can have something that does clarify,
it concerns
for
you a little
meeting.
Bit that you couldn't see that quickly.
No.
So, if you read down this paragraph, you're allowed one temporary sign, right?
Yep, I saw that.
Now, keep going. You're allowed one if you're doing construction, you're allowed one if you're selling your property, you're allowed one for yard sales.
But I'm saying when I look at the table, what you said is the reference. It then says to go to 8.5.6, where if you look at residential zoning districts, it says to go to 8.5.6, so I did that. And then 8.5.6 says special regulations in accordance with section 111.2.8.0. So I still don't know how long I can have my one temporary sign in my resident.
Okay, well, temporary signs are exempt, right? So certain signs, certain temporary signs, let's see. The construction sign, if you're building a house, right? You have that for up to a year, or a property that's going under construction. Political signs, as town council said, have some length of time on them.
Okay.
So the answer to the question is temporary signs are defined by their characteristics, not by how long they endure.
Can be.
They're designed not to be permanent.
Right.
So they're made out of paper
so
or plastic or whatever.
So then it comes down to
whatever.
Definition.
And so then there are provisions for temporary signs, the time limits for temporary signs in certain circumstances. So if you have a sign that is a temporary sign that's being allowed while the property is for sale, that defines how long it can be there.
Okay.
But it's not 30 days or 60 days or 90 days. The property might be a real dog and it may take years to sell it.
Right.
And I don't want to get stuck on it. I'm just saying that I'd really love to know. I know you have a Supreme Court thing. I'd love to know what the AG recommendation was and what we did with it.
Okay,
that's
so let me tell you this.
And I don't need to know it.
Okay.
I think it's the town meeting that needs to know it, not me.
Can I just ask a basic question real quick? Do you and potentially other town meeting members understand the underpinnings of this change, like
that
the reason that
I remember it's the church. I mean, I know about the ruling
that we can't regulate for content.
No, see, and that's what I think would be really cool to talk about.
Okay,
very nice, just to kind of give us a really general viewpoint of what it is, what we're doing, and so we don't go 3 hours in about it.
You already have a memo from me that. In 2 or 3 pages, lays it out.
That would be perfect. I think that would be a wonderful.
That's in the packet on the website.
As far as the attorney,
I think if we put it out there as
advice,
a bullet point, where it wasn't. I mean, for Jean's point, looking in a packet versus having it outside on the sidebar where we can see what it says is easier to find. Because then I've got to go through. I've got to decide which packet it's in, and it gets lost. So if we can just be on the sidebar. That would be really helpful.
Okay.
I will make sure it's on the website.
That's perfect.
Send you an email tomorrow so you can see it and let me know if you think it covers the bases.
That'd be lovely.
Okay.
All right. So
as far as the Attorney General's guidance is, consult town council.
That'd be great to see that she said that. That'd be great if that's what she says.
Okay.
That would be great.
Sure.
Because I think that that is really funny, because that means that you've got 360-something town councils interpreting something.
He's like 60.
He's 60 of them. 351. 351, that's right.
351 cities and towns, but they're not that many town councils. But okay, we can do it.
But you know, I mean, you could have different interpretations. So anyway, that would be nice.
There is an IMLA version, which is a group of attorneys that came together and tried to interpret what the Supreme Court was saying in this decision.
Yep. I mean, I just think we just have some context. I don't want to belabor it, just some context.
I know, but if we get caught up in this in town meeting, nothing's going to get done.
Exactly.
Because it's a silly rule that's really hard. It took us a long time to get through it, and we're still not getting
it. And that's
we're
it,
not
too.
There yet.
It, too. I don't really want to get stuck in it. And if it's like, hey, this is what we've got, this is what we're doing, great. Just give us the guidance instead of us debating it for hours. Wind signs, or I'm sorry, identification signs versus joint identification signs. Are identification signs different than joint identification signs?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like joint identification signs are being eliminated. Is that true?
As a definition?
What's that? So I'm looking at page 4 and 5 of what was online. So the identification sign, the new one, doesn't have anything about, it basically says it contains names and logos, the old one used to say that it contains the names and logos of establishments, but no advertising or promotional information.
Mm-hmm.
And the current identification sign doesn't talk at all about naming or about promotional.
That's right, because that's content.
That's content.
I'm just trying to find what she's looking at.
She's looking at
the other version.
The version
that
was in the public hearing draft.
What's the one, what does it say at the top on the right?
Bold cross out version. So I thought that way that was the easiest one to see what had been done for me.
I just want to raise one point. We're sitting here and it's August 8th. If we need to call this and pull it from the warrant because it needs more work, I'll just throw it out there as a possibility.
What's the date? What's the last possible date?
Well, again,
Selectmen will sign the warrant.
September.
Like the third Tuesday in September.
Yeah. I mean, we're really talking about being so close to the deadline of when things should be in good order. If there's a lot more, you know, we want to continue to drill down and debate and give this additional time, I really think that should be something we should consider. We really don't lose anything. We're not doing enforcement.
The point is that you're not going to resume.
Is there, can we not extend this to the 22nd, our next meeting?
We can, but it's now getting really, really, really tight for turning around town council version, public comments. I mean, it just feels like we've been in this movie before. And if it needs more time and it needs more study, I would suggest consideration of that.
Could it go to April?
Sure.
But we've already started talking about some of the big hit items that we want to start tackling in April.
Well, it's not necessary to give up tonight. You can close the hearing and then you can deliberate to your heart's content. You don't have to make your recommendation until, strictly speaking, you don't have to make your recommendation until town meeting floor, but better practice would be to have a version go on the warrant that you're ready to recommend.
Yes, we've done that before.
So you don't want...
Where?
We don't want to do that.
Yeah, well...
Mr. Chair.
Wait, one second, let me just let him...
So remember when we were doing all of those zoning changes before, we had, when we did the big package of it, there were a lot of changes that happened after the warrant was closed, and that okay, it's legally okay, but it causes great consternation when you're actually debating it. So ideally, you want to have a text that is that you're prepared to endorse by the time the warrant closes, which for some reason I'm thinking it's the 22nd.
It's like September 20 something.
20. So you've got about 6 weeks to do it.
September 27 is when the Board of Selectmen closed the warrant. So the snag is that we meet again on August 22nd. Then we have a problem, potentially, with meeting on September 12th, if that ends up being a special town meeting, which it could be. That's the problem. I mean, unless you want to, again, we've been in this movie before. I have the scars to show it. September 19th, we could potentially meet and be done in time for the Board of Selectmen to close the warrant. But maybe we could do it at the end of August and be done on the 22nd, but it's getting really, really tight.
I mean, theoretically, we could add more meetings if we had to get through this. I don't think any of us want to do that, but mm-hmm. I think too much work's been done on this to, and too much other work has been teed up for subsequent lowercase s town meetings.
Well,
so I'd like to see us try to keep going. I don't know what others have to say. Yeah, go ahead.
Mr. Chair, what I was going to say is, if it's about content, like you, because I brought up something, like if I'm reading something and I go, oh, it changed, and it doesn't have that, teach me early. Give me education ahead of reading it. Just tell me that. Give me examples so that I don't go, hey, it's changed, and now we don't do this. And you're like, that's right. That's because it's content. Teach me ahead. Tell me it's content. I got it. Like, that's, for me, the difference is I can remember, you know, names and things. So, like, in a way, I think I read it, and then I think of an example in town that's why something was written, and then I read it and go, oh, it's different, and now there could be problems. But it's about probably Supreme Court stuff. So just give, I think if you gave town meeting a little bit of education, maybe even before we even jump into this, a little education, maybe your slides that you're going to give to us at the town meeting would be very helpful. So I'm not going to talk about, it sounds like the identification stuff is something that is a change that was made because we no longer can enforce content. Is that correct?
So we've defined, so the point is we have currently a definition of joint identification sign,
yep,
which is defined by its purpose. Okay? Serves as a common or collective identification for a group of persons or business operating in the same lot, and
yep,
which contains the name. So it says what the content of it is. And then later on there's a provision that says joint identification signs are permitted in this context.
All right.
Okay?
Okay.
So the problem with that is that we have defined it based on what the sign says.
Yep.
So now the new definition
is more general.
A sign containing areas that are made available for use incidental to the individual structures or commercial uses operating on the premises or site on which the sign is located.
And I read that and I went, what? It's
okay.
Very vague. Like,
okay.
Very, so vague. That
I guess if you've been doing it for a little while and dealing with what the Supreme Court said, and the subsequent rules that came up, the Alito rules that came out,
yes,
which cleared it up a little bit,
yes,
then you'd probably understand that.
Yeah, okay, and that's fine. I mean, again, if it was originally intended to be understood by laypeople,
simple,
for business.
Simple example is you can't. We can't tell them not to put a for sale sign up, but a house that is for sale may have a sign. That's the stuff we've been dealing with.
All right. So I'll be better. And
now you can see why my FU sign is appropriate.
Exactly. So I really have very, I don't want to belabor. I wanted to say that the letters on 10 on that you're looking at, Julie, on 10, go DGHI.
Oh, yeah, that's all going to be
perfect. Perfect. Okay. And then the other part that I was, there was just, there's a difference in page 13, you say wind, banners, and feather flags, but when you define it, you say the opposite. So is that corrected?
It's corrected in my comments.
Okay, so that's where I took it. And the other one was on 3E, on page 12, which is about a flag, and this was the one that was, and I guess my question is, I know why it was written. It was written for somebody like Swiss bakers, that they could put a Swiss flag up. It wouldn't count as their only flag. They could have a Swiss flag and they can have an open flag. Mm. So that's why that was written. Could they still do that? Could Swiss bakers still have their Swiss flag up and still have an open flag?
Sorry, you're saying page?
Page 12. Number, the one that was stricken out about a national or state flag with emblems.
What does it say at the top on the right?
Bold cross out version.
Okay.
So I know that was written like for Swiss bakers, because they had a Swiss flag and they were saying you can't have two flags. You can't have an open flag and you can't have a Swiss flag. And so we added it in there so that they actually could have a Swiss flag and could have an open flag. Can they still do that?
Which one is it, sorry?
3E, page 12, the top of page 12.
Okay. Oh, I see.
See?
Okay.
So that was stricken out.
Well, because we can't.
We can't say that.
Can't
you can't say
open.
An open flag, but you can say a flag.
Right. So, but are they only allowed one flag? That's my question.
There's.
It depends on which version we're going with, Chair. I believe Town Council has included flags in government signs.
Yes.
Which would make a Swiss flag, being a government flag, exempt, and then they would be allowed an open flag. I don't think the versions before that included flags as exempt signs.
No, when we say government, we don't mean any other government.
No, because it just says federal,
it does say federal, state.
Federal.
Yeah, it says federal, state, local.
Right, so that doesn't include a Swiss flag.
It doesn't include
a non-U.S. flag is a decorative flag. It's like an open flag.
So you're saying that they would not be able, they used to be able to do two in our current sign bylaws, and they will now only be able to do one.
I don't know about that. Hold on.
Just wondering.
Flag is a temporary sign, right? Mm-hmm. There are a lot more than one temporary sign. We'd have to look at that one.
Okay. I just wanted to let you know that that's why I was there.
Yeah, no, it's good context.
So
thank you.
I don't care. I just wanted to let you know that that's
sure.
why I was at it.
Sure.
With page 15 of the same ruling, is on clocks. It's F right now. And it says that provided that what was stricken out was that provided that they display no advertising or commercial material. I like the fact that somebody like the bank on the corner could have a clock and have their name on the bottom. But this, the current sign by law says that they couldn't do that. With you striking it out, could they do that?
Town Council and I differ on whether you can say advertising. Because another group of lawyers says I can.
Uh-oh. Okay.
The IMLA stuff said that Alito's comments seemed to indicate that it didn't go so far as to say that you couldn't say something as advertising. You can say that. We've been discussing for a while. We probably struck it because it's related to content.
Okay, So the answer would, so they could then.
I don't think they should, unless it's part of their sign.
But they could.
These signs can have. So they'll have their sign, then they'll add a clock with another sign, then they'll have a sign on the window, then they'll have a sign carved into the doorway.
But it's a clock. It just has a sign on it. It just has a name on it.
It has a sign.
So my view of it is that a clock is a sign. And.
Do we say that?
And it, in my version.
Okay.
It says the clock is an electronic sign. And so you can have it and it can have anything on it, but it counts as a sign.
Mm-hmm.
Because one of the things, and this is, I'm just going to put it out, one of the things that we at one point had said is, one of the selectmen at one point had said, it would be so cool to have a clock in the middle of town, you know, right on the corner. It would look really nice. And maybe we can get a bank to sponsor it. But if a bank sponsored it, it really couldn't have a name on it.
Well, that's not on their property.
It could. If you're going to put it, where are you having in mind?
She was thinking about on the corner you turn on Haven.
It's not on their property. It's an off-premises. It would be technically an off-premises sign, but if it belongs to the town somehow,
so then the town can
the
be
town
in.
Is exempt. They
okay.
can put any sign they want on.
Yeah. Well, that's cool. All right, good.
We don't prohibit the little garden signs, right? We don't worry about those. You know, somebody provides the gardening for it, provided
the
by
adopted
the
adopted island.
Yeah, adopted island
yeah.
stuff.
Yeah.
Well, that was, so those are the only things. I thought it really reads well. I just don't understand enough of the new context around it, and I just wanted to say that would be really nice if maybe you could get some examples in.
We've
if any consolation, I don't think the Supreme Court understands it either. So, which is to say that there is a majority opinion, and then there's a concurring opinion which attempted to clean up the majority opinion. Because majority opinion basically says if you have to read the sign in order to regulate it, then the regulation is unconstitutional. And Alito wrote a concurring opinion and said, well, here's a list of things that are still permitted. And some of those, he just directly contradicts what Thomas wrote in the majority opinion. We just have to.
So does one or the other override? Which the later one?
Well, the majority opinion is the one that Thomas wrote. So that's, in theory, the one you have to go with. If there's a contradiction, you have to go with. In fact, pretty much everybody who is we've participated in an endless number of webinars on this, and pretty much all of the scholars who are looking at this are taking the position that you're allowed to follow Alito, even though Thomas's opinion had more votes. So that's what we've been trying to do.
Has the Attorney General weighed in on any of the bylaws that went to Springtown meeting?
Yes. All of them.
Didn't we provide that at one point?
We provided somebody.
He collected them.
Well, we could update it, but all of the bylaws that went to Springtown meeting that have been acted on have been approvals. With maybe there was one that had a little bit of something
like cautions,
but they all come with the caution: interpreting this, you must be sure to interpret it in accordance with Reed, and see your town council. So, thank you. So she's not sticking her neck out.
Online gambling, a lot more fun, exciting stuff.
So should we?
All right. Well, it's 9:15. have we exhausted our time on signs?
I think so.
I mean, so. Should I go through it and digest it and see what comes of like making the changes we discussed and then adopting the changes he's proposing, and then you guys can look at it on the 22nd?
I think the three of us should do that.
Okay.
And then we might have to have another meeting.
Okay, so we'll schedule something in the next week.
Yeah.
let's talk, because I'm going to really get a lot of travel in the next few weeks or something.
Okay.
And I can't be there on the 22nd.
Okay.
So just want to make sure we have a quorum.
So far I know of three people who will be coming on the 22nd.
All right.
Karen, Nick, and Dave.
Yeah, I can make the 22nd.
Can you still make the 22nd, Karen?
I guess so.
I don't know about John. Okay. So, all right.
So, just so we're clear, I can offer you two approaches. One is, as I pointed out, there were a few things that I didn't get to that I wanted to get to, notably reconciling the table with the text. I can do that the next couple of days, and then you can work from that, if that's what you'd like.
It's probably
sure.
better
yeah.
to have you do that. Yeah,
okay. All right.
So the
as
working
soon as you schedule
group.
That meeting, let me know, so that becomes a hard day.
Okay.
The working group should meet, if possible, next week, early next week.
I will be in California on Monday.
Tuesday
Wednesday, or
our Tuesday night time slot is kind of a good one. And I have to be at the Board of Selectmen at 7, but
true.
The group can, in the past, has met on Tuesday, like 6 o'clock.
What day is it?
That's the 16th. And that'll give you enough time to go through and.
If you were saying you wanted to meet tomorrow, I was going to. That would be hard.
A week from tomorrow.
Piece of cake.
And then. Okay.
That would work for me.
Does that work for you, Tony?
Yes, that works. The 22nd that week I'm out.
Yeah, that's 22nd week. After Monday, I'm not available.
And then the 22nd. So as soon as we get our draft and I'll send it to you. And then we'll discuss this again on the 22nd. And if we don't feel like you can vote on whether to put it on the warrant, then we'll consider future dates.
Future dates for more discussion?
For town meeting, right?
Future. Oh, you mean pushing it off?
Well, I mean.
Yeah. I think if we can get this in final form on the 22nd, or you know, pretty close to final form.
Yeah.
I think we're good. If we can't, I mean, I don't even know when we're going to meet in September. The 12th, for all intents and purposes, you know, the 5th is Labor Day, the 12th, we think there's going to be a special town meeting. That only leaves the 19th and the 22nd.
26th.
And they're closing the 26th, and then they're closing the warrant on the 27th, so that's really. In my opinion, you get to the 19th and it's still not ready. We're in the same nightmare we were a couple of years ago, which wasn't fun.
What about the other ones? What about the other changes we're proposing?
That's the next item on the agenda.
All right.
All right, so hold on. Let's not get off signs yet. I just want to make sure that we're not. I felt like we were good there. I just want to make sure we weren't tied to that extended timeline for the other ones as well. We can break those out, vote on those.
No, they're all separate.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so signage, if I understood correctly, there'll be a few meetings prior to the 22nd, or at least one meeting prior to the 22nd, and then a discussion on the 22nd, and at the conclusion of that discussion, if people are not comfortable that what we have is good, then we will not head it to the warrant.
Mr. Chairman, if you could ask Town Council if he could, when he's doing the review, kind of highlight those which he really thinks need to be changed and those which would be nice to be changed. Kind of prioritize them, if possible.
Absolutely. Is that something you can accommodate?
So if you would strike something out in bold, I really don't agree with
that.
Really, really, really.
Or even highlight it in yellow, the really bad stuff.
Red.
All right.
I don't think the pointer does it.
I'll give it a try.
Yeah. Constitutional, unconstitutional.
Yeah.
Just draw the line right there.
Base it on the case history from Reed.
Okay.
challenge.
There is none.
I'm
didn't supply any, right?
Right. Now, they didn't bother. One of the things that just, I hate to publicly disparage a Supreme Court justice, but usually if the Supreme Court announces a new rule, they go through all of the case law leading up and they say, we're overruling this case, or we're interpreting that case to mean something that's consistent with what we're doing now, so that you're not left with a whole body of case law. The Supreme Court has dealt with signs probably a dozen times in the last century. And the majority opinion does not acknowledge that any of that prior case law exists. And that's what Alito was trying to do is to rehabilitate it, saying, well, we didn't overrule this case, so it must still be good.
Mm-hmm. Is that setting a precedent, or has that happened before?
No, I'm sure it's happened before. I'm not a constitutional scholar, really. This is deeper into the weeds than I tend to have to go. But I'm sure it's happened before. The people who run the various webinars and stuff are apoplectic over this, because they're trying to educate municipal lawyers so that municipal lawyers can give out good advice. And
yep.
The truth of the matter is, it's really difficult.
Okay. All right. You have an application scheduled at 9:30 for Home Depot.
Is that what you're here for, sir?
Yes.
Do you want to take that one?
And
then come back?
Yeah, maybe that's best.
Okay.
And you're done with us, right?
Well, I think if we want to continue with the zoning and just wrap up the last piece with town council here, that might not be a bad idea.
So there's two things.
Okay.
I want you to review the revised language of accessory buildings and structures and accessory apartment, which I incorporated feedback we received from just two people.
Did you get any more feedback from Nancy?
Yes, she and I met and went over it all, and then I revised it, and then she looked at it, and so I want to be for you guys. We went back and forth a couple times, and she likes what is done here. She's the only person that I've heard from regarding accessory buildings and structures. And then I heard from her and Brad Latham on the square footage of an accessory apartment. So I just tried to incorporate their feedback as best as I could. So.
There's a case in front of CBA for a pool, I think.
Is there?
Does this fix that?
I don't know about that case. Is it larger or in a setback?
I don't know what variance they're seeking, whether it's a setback or a size.
So right now, like with this change, we would allow, if it meets the setbacks, it can be any size. If it's within the setbacks, it can be 600 square feet or 25% of the gross floor area of the structure. So,
okay.
But her big things were pulling garages out, so they're their own section, so that they don't get confused with other accessory structures, and then also allowing them to be closer to the side yard than 10 feet. Because she actually showed me some lots where, based on the dimensions of the lot, if you require it to be behind and at least 10 feet from the side lot line, the person to get into the garage of the right size for two cars ends up having to pave their entire lot to get around. So she showed me a bunch of different examples of projects she's worked on that have been challenged by the way that the bylaw is currently written.
What about height? Weren't we having a discussion about height?
Yeah, and then that was her other thing. So if you look under 2D, there's some provisions she thought would better regulate. So Glenn was worried that if we just said one story and we didn't give it a number, someone then comes back later and finishes that upstairs portion and makes an accessory dwelling unit, and then it's 5 feet from the lot line and it's overlooking someone's yard or their house. So she thought there was a better way to regulate it than actually just putting a number on it, because the number then would limit like the style of the roof you could have, and you might want your garage roof style to match your house roof style, and she drew up a number of examples of that. So this is what she thought.
She's limiting the plate to 9 feet, no dormers and no full staircase.
And the 9-foot plate is just on the edges, so it's not like someone could still do a cathedral ceiling, but they can't.
I know what the top plate is, but I don't know if everybody else does.
I don't know if everyone else
does. I know. That's the trick. She said that anyone in her industry, I asked, and she said anyone in her industry would know what that is.
No, it's true. She's right. It makes sense. So. And I don't know that everybody does need to know it, as long as the building inspector knows.
The building inspector, yeah.
You can show them what they're doing wrong if they're doing something wrong.
Right.
The builder will know it. And an architect would know it, who may be drawing it up.
In 2B, and is permitted at any size. What is that?
Hold on, let me read it. Oh yeah, so if it meets the setbacks for a principal structure, you can build a 3-car garage. You're not limited to the 600 square foot requirement. Like if you have an enormous lot and you're able to fit things on it, you're limited by lot coverage.
Okay.
That will still limit you.
And that provision applies to attached garages as well. So attached garages aren't really accessory buildings or structures.
No. But we wanted to put both in there just to be clear. Because we consider a garage that's within 10 feet of the house is attached. If you read
above.
Yeah,
I remember that.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
So we just are trying to be very clear about what we mean. Or if you have a house where you have a garage that partly meets the setbacks but partly doesn't, if the garage goes into the setback, then it wouldn't. It's attached, but it doesn't conform, so it wouldn't have to meet this.
Okay, so we need to rename. If you're going to have a section that on garages that are not accessory buildings or structures, we might need to think about where we are going to rename the section.
Wait, what do you mean? Garages are accessory.
Well, if they're part of the main building, they're not an accessory building or structure.
It says if you look at D, 1D, it's considered attached to the principal structure. It's not considered that it's not accessory.
So anything that's attached is considered something else.
It's still considered accessory, but it's, I don't know, it's like a gray area.
All right, I need to think on that one.
So if it's attached, it goes by what the principal structure is.
I mean, you know, some garages are don't even stick out from the house at all. They're just
right,
under the house.
Under, right.
Yeah, I don't know if we need the word attached. So if it's attached, then the entire structure needs to be in the outside of the setbacks.
No. I would say just that part, it's the accessory, the garage, like if it's in the setback, then it can't be, like maybe a portion of it meets the setback and a portion doesn't.
No, but
doesn't.
If you have a single structure that has, you know, if you think about a typical center entrance colonial, it's got a garage, two-car garage, and over that is probably like a master bedroom suite or something, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe different roof height. That's not an accessory building or structure. That's part of the house. That is the main structure, and all of that has to be within the setbacks.
So I guess some garages are accessory and some are not.
Detached ones. I don't think that an attached garage can ever be accessory if it's part of the main structure. It's
no.
Just a use. So you've got kitchens and you've got garages.
I'm just trying to work with this bylaw and with the building inspector. I've never, honestly, in my life, never seen this.
I mean, if you put quotes around detached, if you put quotes around it, but then it's detached. If you put quotes around it, then I think you're okay.
I did put quotes
around it. She did put quotes around
it. Down in 2B. That's where I'm having trouble with this, 2B. Any attached or detached.
Put quotes around the word attached.
Because then it meets the definition kind of that you're wanting. You're talking about up top. That's the only thing I would have an issue with.
Okay.
Or be concerned with.
Then performance standards was the other one you wanted us to look at?
Yeah, it's the size, allowable size for an accessory apartment. And both Nancy and Brad Latham thought that 750 square feet was very small if you're considering gross square footage. And Nancy showed me some drawings of some recent accessory dwelling units that she's done that are tight even at 1,000 square feet when you consider gross. They both agree that it needs to be more than 750, and they both said 900 to 1,200, somewhere in there. So.
But then hinging it on one-third of the gross floor area, were they still comfortable with that?
Yeah.
Tony?
Mr. Chairman, 1,000 square feet is 25 by 40. That's basically a ranch home.
That's huge.
I think that's what my mother has.
Yeah.
It's easily a two bedroom.
Easily three.
I don't know, she's not here. I honestly,
sure.
I'm just trying
not
to incorporate
here.
The feedback that I heard. It's the only feedback I heard until Tony just spoke, so.
I did a lot of housing in my younger days, and we can do magic with 700 to 900 square feet. Accessory apartment. It's not supposed to be some luxury condo rental. It's really to serve a use. You know, people are trying to get their in-laws in or you know, child. It's not really supposed to be
a
condo.
So this is her.
Condo.
Could we have a provision that makes it family use?
Because I had it at 900, and then she said, actually.
We went down that road, and no one wanted to do that.
Those are temporary. You know, you bring your sick elderly person in for a while. When they're gone, you have this accessory apartment, you should be allowed to rent it.
Whether or not it should be a family.
Required that it
yeah.
be a family.
Yeah. I spent a lot of time on that when I worked in the city of Peabody. And it was actually regulated by the city council, and it was a beast to manage. a lot of the cities and towns do. But it's the capacity to administer it.
Do we want to take a vote on if we should increase that?
Again, we're talking about gross, so that's different than what a net living area would be.
Accessory apartment is going to be part of the original structure, right?
It can be attached or detached.
Concern
that includes basements or either, right?
What's that?
See, it says here that it's exclusive of any garage. Oh, that's part of the main house.
One third of the gross floor area, excluding in the gross floor area, principal single family dwelling, excluding garage, unfinished basement shed.
So it seems like if we don't change it, it will come up on town meeting floor.
Oh yeah.
And it seems like that could take us down.
If we don't change what?
If we keep it at 750.
Well, yeah,
there will be a floor amendment, and then there will become a debate on that. And
actually, we're making this a max, right? This is a maximum of 1,000, so I guess
not to exceed either the lesser of 1,000 or a third of the gross floor area.
The lesser, so on a 2,400 square foot house here,
it's 800.
Okay, I guess I would just leave it because you're right; it's going to come up.
Tony?
Mr. Chairman, I guess you could go larger because there's also a limitation in the bylaw under, I want to say, is it J? Sorry. One of them says it can only be a two-bedroom anyhow. An accessory apartment may not be occupied by more than three people nor have more than two bedrooms. Hmm.
Did you guys want to vote on including the ones you agree on everything but the sign bylaw on the warrant? And then we can do home depot.
Yeah.
So, are we voting just to include or voting to approve?
Like.
Or endorse?
Endorse. I think we just vote to put it on the warrant at this point, right?
Well, yeah. Usually we do two votes. We vote to include in the warrant, and then we vote the actual language.
Right.
If you're ready for that.
Okay. Tony, you had a.
I had a question going back to the accessory buildings and structures, and it relates to the accessory apartments. Section 1C states that accessory apartments are not subject to the requirements of Section 5.5.1.
Mm-hmm.
Has the board or town staff looked at the implications of eliminating the accessory structures from an accessory apartment?
No, we're saying accessory apartments are taken out of accessory structures. They have their own, like you just read from, they have their own guidelines.
Right, but I don't know if anybody's looked to confirm that all of the guidelines in accessory buildings are covered. For example, lot coverage, side setbacks, and so forth.
Well, lot coverage is under section 6.
Mm-hmm. I was just concerned that there might have been a provision in 5.51 that is eliminated, and now next thing you know, an accessory apartment could be more than 25% coverage, could be within 2 feet of a lot line instead of 5 feet.
Okay, I'll look at that. Maybe we won't vote on this one tonight.
Well, you can vote to put it on the board. But you've got a logic problem with C, because the first sentence of C says accessory apartments are only as permitted pursuant to 5.47, and then it says it's not subject to the requirements of 5.51, which would include the previous sentence.
Sure.
So that needs a little tweak there. But if this one is certainly close enough that if you're not voting on the actual language right now, you're just voting approval on the
board. We can do that.
All right, so how many votes do we need?
We need to vote to include it in the warrant. We could just include both of these in the warrant. We could vote on another meeting.
So we've got accessory apartment, accessory structures, and then site plan review?
Lot shape, pet grooming, and renumbering, and special home occupation.
Can we do all those in one vote? Yeah.
Otherwise, I need a list to read off to make motions. If you want me to make a motion for each one of them, I need to see them.
I'm trying to think of the agenda.
One motion. Okay.
One.
Sure.
To include
just
all
make
the
sure you list
warrant.
The four things that are going to be included in it.
I need to see them.
Hold on.
So it's 5.5 accessory building structures. 5.4. 7.3.
Hold on, I have the legal ad right here. I can just read from that. So.
Dave, so. All right, move that the CPDC vote to include the following bylaw, zoning bylaw revisions in the warrant. Section 4.6, site plan review, the addition of pet grooming as a by right use in section 5.3.1, table of uses for business and industrial districts, with a definition in section 2.0 definitions. Special home occupation as a use allowed by special permit in the table of accessory uses for residential districts, with the addition of section 5.6.7, special home occupation outlining parameters for approval. Revisions to section 5.5, accessory buildings or structures, and minor revisions to section 4.3, Community Planning and Development Commission. Section 4.7.3b, accessory apartments, and section 6.2.1, lot shape.
I'll second that. All those in favor? No. Another one?
Do you want to do language for everything but 5.5 on that list?
Dave would say so moved, something like that.
Yeah.
Except I said it and I'm not a commissioner.
All right. Move that the CPDC vote to approve the language? Is that what you say? Or endorse?
Endorse
the language of the aforementioned articles.
With
the exception.
5.5 accessory structures.
With the exception of section 5.5 accessory buildings or structures.
Second. All those in favor? Very good.
All right.
Good.
The warrant.
Now you're done.
Now we're done. For now.
Almost.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Okay, thank you.
Sir, sorry for the long delay. Come on up. Next up on the agenda, we've got the minor modification to Home Depot at 60 Walkers Brook Drive. Julie, any opening comments on this one?
Yeah, it's pretty straightforward. We've been working with Home Depot to ensure that they keep their outdoor storage within the marked outdoor storage areas on the plan. And in meeting with them, they indicated that they have 10 spaces that were dedicated for Penske truck rental that they aren't using, and that they'd like to remove a portion of the site closer to the tool rental center to use for tool rental. And because the original special permit for the PUDI requires that even the most minor of modifications come before you guys, that's why they're here tonight. They're basically swapping 10 spaces in one area for 10 spaces in another area of the site. So.
And you might recall, for those of you who are on the board, that the Penske truck rental was another fairly elaborate amendment to the special permit back about 3-4 years ago?
Four years.
Oh my gosh.
That was my first meeting.
It was. Yes. Okay, so you remember it well.
Very first meeting. Right.
Well, there was confusion about whether it was an allowed use, right?
Yeah.
Part of that.
Never forget that.
It was very, very tricky.
We even had the two boards. We had the
zoning board because you changed the parking.
Right.
And you needed a variance.
Yep.
And then you had to come here to amend the special permit.
All right, good time.
So that was 4 years ago, and now we're, there's a shift, and that never happened, the Penske truck rental, correct?
I think it did for a while, but I believe Penske may have opened up their own facility somewhere very close. So then it didn't make sense to keep it there anymore.
Okay.
This is already being used like this anyways.
Those Penske spaces are what we're going to be Penske are swapped out for the other 10 closer.
Okay.
Okay.
No, like I said, this is really just a matter of record, right? Because it's already being used like this.
But did they get restriped or anything?
They
like
do.
Bigger stripes?
They already have been, actually, restriped.
Oh, okay. Okay. And then these will get restriped back to what they were.
They just remove, like, an outline.
Oh, all right.
Yep. Whatever indication they are. That they're
all right.
Big eraser out there.
Right? Yeah. Take
that
sign from over there. Kramer's painting over lines on the highway.
The adopt a highway.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, so it's just. No signage is approved, but they have signs on all the equipment saying this stuff for rent. Does that count?
None of the signs that we currently require sign permit applications for.
Oh, excellent.
And we can't afford it anyway, so.
That's right.
It's a free-for-all.
It's just,
oh, man. Well, you can.
This is just so that they don't put up a big sign by these 10 spots, that a big freestanding sign that says Tool Rental Center. Because oh, that's not approved.
Ten signs, one in each spot.
Right, yeah.
But they're low.
Any questions, comments? Any comment? Yeah, I'm sorry. Any public comments? All right.
Okay. Move that the CPDC vote to approve the minor amendment to PUDI special permit at 60 Walker's Brook Drive.
Second.
All those in favor? All right.
Thank
great.
You very much.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks.
A record plan from DHB.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Great.
Very good. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks.
Good
bye-bye.
To see you again.
Good to
thank
see you.
You.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Came all the way from Somerset,
New Jersey. Yeah.
When they called, I spoke to the guy, not him, last week, and he indicated he was sending someone, and I was like, do what you want, but I was like, you know, why can't, like, Joanne from Home Depot be here?
No, he always handles it.
I mean, that's ridiculous, though.
He came up here from New Jersey?
Mm-hmm. I tried to, like,
Penske.
Impress upon him how minor this was, though.
Yeah. No, he's the one.
Well, hopefully he's staying over at one of our B&B things over there.
Airbnb.
Airbnb.
Only if they're paying taxes to the town.
I realize we keep putting off meeting minutes. Do we want to just...
No, you should just bang them out this time.
Just bang them out.
Yeah. Bang them out.
I think
have your election. Don't forget about that.
Yeah.
We're doing that tonight?
Can we do that when we have a full board?
It's up to you.
Yeah, I was thinking that too.
It's up to you.
Are we going to have a full board?
Not next time.
Not next time.
And then you don't have a meeting after that until the end of September, so...
That's
we're
fine.
Thinking one meeting in September.
I think John should be chair and Dave should be vice chair.
Oh my gosh.
Teach them.
That's
the vice chair. We've never used the term vice chair before. So
okay.
We've secretary.
Assistant chair.
Secretary.
Secretary.
Deputy.
Yeah.
Deputy.
Number two.
Vice chancellor.
Treasurer.
Treasurer.
For all those big,
yeah, those big,
big earnings.
Let's wait on it until September. That's fine. And
okay. So, you should do minutes. You've got a lot. They're really stacking up.
I've sent in comments on the 6th, the 20th, and the 21st. So I'm good on all those.
I didn't have any comments on the 6th. I sent two comments on the 20th.
Yeah.
Something minor.
So Jeff, I must have incorporated your comments on the ones on the 6th. I didn't. What I usually do is I write them on my copy and then I bring them up. But I don't have anything written here. So I don't know.
Maybe
if
I didn't have anything on the 6th.
I remember you sent me comments for the 20th. For the 6th, you had some questions which I answered.
Yeah, that's fine.
And so for the 20th, I need to change on page 1 to say Mr. Safina read the legal notice into the record instead of Chair Hansen.
Okay.
Because that's,
yeah, that's right.
What you guys always do. I'm just sleeping over here, apparently.
Just hanging out.
And same thing on page 2. And then Jeff had a comment that I should add a note above the first public comment that he opened the hearing to public comment, and that's good. And then Nick, you had a question about the word exorbitant on page 3, about 2/3 of the way down the page.
Well, what's the sentence?
It says, Mike Hansen of 17 Plymouth Road stated that it would be a shame for these natural habitats to be destroyed. He asked what kind of consideration is given to long-term residents who have concerns about the project. He opined that the number of waivers seems exorbitant. So this is in relation to Lyle Estates. And you put a question mark.
Yeah. Why did I do that? Did they have that many waivers?
I thought maybe he just didn't like the word. It was the exact word he said.
Is it exactly what he said?
Yeah, but it...
If you wrote it down, then he said it. That's fine. So it's, you said he opined, so it's his opinion.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't think they had that many waivers. That's why.
Oh, I know. Well. I don't disagree. Okay. And then, Nick, on page 4, you said that you made a clarification to the second paragraph under the Bully Coley minor site plan review that about what your actual questions were, and that you didn't question the need for the canopy, but potentially Jeff or Dave did. So I was just going to...
The canopy?
Yeah,
I think Dave did. Dave was questioning
Dave.
The actual canopy that comes out with the bump, you know, the building bumps out.
So I'll just add that Dave asked about that.
There was a comment in there that we were calling the engineer who was here, either the architect or something else.
Oh, no, he kept saying when you were going out about the architecture that he's not the architect. But I didn't call him an architect.
Okay.
Did we ever hear back from him?
Actually, no. But they won't get their,
Yeah.
Maybe it's taking them a while to redesign. They're thoughtfully incorporating all of your feedback.
Fertile change, yeah.
Guy's probably looking for energy.
I don't want to force any particular style on anyone, but if someone's going to throw garbage at us and waste our time to review it, then I'm going to call them out. You know, it was something that they threw at us to somehow occupy our time to get that permit done, and then that's not really fair to us.
Yeah.
And then, Nick, you had a comment on page 5 after, this was with the Pizza Town sign, and you wanted me to include something that said how the CPDC was uncomfortable with the break from the uniform appearance with the rest of the building.
Yeah.
So I will add that word for word, like what you said.
So we gave him the red sign he wanted, but he really didn't like that it sort of broke with the whole rest of the signs.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. Those are the changes. Karen, do you have anything?
Okay, so we didn't have any changes to the 6th, it sounds like.
Nope.
And we had changes to the 20th, so we can do those now. So I move that the CPDC approve the meeting minutes of June 6th, 2016.
Second. All those in favor?
Move that the CPDC approve the meeting minutes of June 20th, 2016 as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? What was the 21st again? Was that the really short?
That was when you guys were at the Board of Selectmen meeting.
Yeah, so it basically just references their meeting minutes.
Yes, it does.
Joint meeting.
Okay.
Okay. So then, if no one has any comments on those, move that the CPDC approve the meeting minutes of June 21st, 2016.
Second. All those in favor? I've never done seconds before.
No.
As chairman.
I haven't looked at these yet, so.
Feeling a little empowered. All right, let's take a look at these real quick, just knock them out.
under accessory buildings or structures. The third line down, as well as the proposed changes instead of proposed the changes.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
So he said this one or this one, I think. Because I remember looking at the calendar. Bob gave us like three or four dates, right?
Yeah.
And we thought this, for some reason, we thought this would be the best
yeah.
one. And then this, it turns out.
That's the election.
So that's not possible anyway.
No.
I might be making that up. Just a disclaimer.
That's right, I'm with you.
I don't remember.
I'm with you.
But I think that was one of them.
The calendar just gets so tight.
Third paragraph from the bottom. Last sentence, I think it should be they agreed. Not
sorry, what'd you say?
Page 3.
Yeah.
Third paragraph from the bottom. The last sentence, they agreed, not the agreed.
Oh, thank you.
Me too.
You good with the 11?
Good. All right. Move that the CPDC approve the meeting minutes of July 11, 2016 as amended.
Second. Excuse me. All those in favor? One more.
Four.
selectmen too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I compared them to Paula's, who are substantially similar. So, not exactly, but so.
Yeah.
Not like directly opposed statements.
Diametrically opposed.
Right.
Hey, Julie.
Yep.
On page 3, the fifth paragraph down, you wrote a developer pointed out. Do we not know his name?
So there's a few people I didn't catch the names of, and neither did Paula for the Board of Selectmen. So
that's
the
right.
Same ones we didn't catch, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm. Wasn't it the one that was sitting with Bob? He was the one that raised his hand and said that the lots are shallow.
Yeah, I mean, he seemed like a guy that we want to touch
with.
Was he sitting
towards
the front?
Because in my memory, because Bob was in the front, in my memory, the guy was kind of like over on the right, a couple tables back.
I felt like he was right in the middle.
No?
Yeah, I think he was sitting with Bob, and he was the one that said, you know, the lots, the depth of the lots, you really ought to look at that. And
was it Freeman?
Yeah,
Dave
no,
Freeman?
No, it wasn't Dave Freeman, but it began with an F.
I have his name at home, Julie.
Oh,
he,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think he owns property, like, over by St. Agnes.
I thought he provided some good feedback.
Yeah.
He definitely did.
So
yeah.
I'd like to keep in touch with him.
It wasn't Michael Carpinella, was it?
No.
So I'm just looking at the names on who signed in. So we have Dave Freeman.
Mm-mm.
Bob would remember.
Mm.
Some people didn't sign in, too.
Mm.
I'm good on these.
Sure.
I can see if I can find out.
Yeah,
and then if I get
Karen's
the name
got
off.
It.
Yeah.
Okay, so no letters.
Hopefully. Are you good?
I'm voting on the content. I wasn't at this meeting. I'm voting on the grammar and the text. I don't think it matters. Okay. I move that the CPDC approve the meeting minutes for July 19th, 2016.
Second. All those in favor? Any other updates, things you want to bring up with us?
There's a bunch of stuff happening on the economic development side of things, and I don't know at what point there'll be much to report, but we're looking at some of the best practices around other communities, and we're bringing back one of our former planning people. Jesse Wilson's going to give us a hand with a special project. This is to get us kind of up to speed before we hire the economic development coordinator. So that work's kind of going on in the background. And hopefully we'll start advertising for the economic development coordinator. And I think that's really it. I mean, we know that, you know, the 40B St. Agnes, we got the notice today from the state that we have 30 days to write our letter. So we've got that done. We knew that was coming. So that's
the next 40B. And the one that's down at the train station, Reading Village, that's continued to August 25th.
Yeah.
And then there's a third one that's in the works as well, sort of out in the periphery. So I don't have too many details on that one yet. So.
It's 40B season.
Yeah.
Apparently.
Yep, so we get economic development and 40Bs.
Maybe we should have a special tax on 40Bs. Raise revenue that way.
Yep. The post office is coming, I don't know when, but.
How about pulling by?
They're all leased.
Oh, we don't know who it is though.
Medical.
Some lock up on this?
I don't know.
The whole space?
Yeah. Yep.
So the Pamplin House is the only retail space on that floor, right?
Well, there's the Hitching Post.
Oh, is that in there?
Well, that's the next building next door, but.
Zynga.
Zynga. I mean, there's the gym, that's retail, isn't it?
Really?
No.
Unless you want to sit outside and watch people work out.
Okay, so there's Zynga and Pamplemousse. And then the next building, there's the Hitching Post and everything but the dog. We actually had a meeting with the downtown retailers this morning. Talk about, we're going to be applying for some grants for wayfinding and branding. And, opening up the discussion about downtown parking, which is something we've been talking about. So,
you know, that's a good opportunity if we control the wayfinding and branding,
mm-hmm.
that we can give them the additional signage they want, but we can do it in a way that's compatible with the feel we're trying to create.
Yep.
There.
Yep. There's a guy, he's an architect, and the state funds, I think, one project a year. Woburn's going through it now, and Winchester's done it, Ipswich has done it,
Concord,
and they just go through a whole process of trying to brand and identify, you know, kind of what we are, and then come up with a really nice design.
Is that expensive?
Execute.
Does that have to be a large grant?
It's a long haul of public meetings and this and that and feedback. That's what makes it expensive, the time.
Because one project a year. Low likelihood that one town.
This would be our second crack at it.
Okay.
So we might.
I'm just wondering if the chamber or somebody else would want to help. We don't have our facade improvement thing anymore, right?
I know. Wakefield just started a special. The retailers stay open a little bit later on Thursdays, so we were talking about it this morning. Melrose does. For the first Thursdays, Wakefield does the first Thursdays, Melrose does the third Thursdays. So I had thrown it out there, maybe we should be thinking about the second Thursdays, staying open and whatnot. So we talked about that too. I guess we'll see.
Okay.
When we hire this new person, I think we'll be able to roll out a bunch of stuff.
We're kind of getting lots of things queued.
Yep.
Nice.
It's going to be a busy job.
All right. We good?
Yeah. Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
All right. Thank you.